Here we're asked to find the partial fraction decomposition of this rational function. Now there's one thing, very important thing, that we need to notice right from the beginning here. And that's that this is what we call an improper rational function. That means the degree of the numerator is greater than the degree of the denominator. Now to be able to use the process of partial fractions, our rational function has to be proper. So that means that we can't actually use partial fraction decomposition on this rational function in its current form. We're still going to be able to do it, we just need to do a little bit of preliminary work first. And the way we're going to make this proper is by using long division of polynomials. So here I've set up our division problem. So let's go through this together. So remember, when I'm doing long division of polynomials, what I'm going to start by looking at is this first term underneath the division sign and the first term outside the division sign. And in this particular case, what I'm asking myself is how many times does x cubed go into 2x to the fourth? Or in other words, x cubed times blank equals 2x to the fourth. So the answer to that question is 2x. So I'm going to put a 2x up top here. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take 2x and multiply it by this whole expression outside my division sign here and write it underneath. So if I multiply 2x by this expression and distribute, I'm going to get 2x to the fourth minus 4x cubed plus 2x squared. And I'm subtracting that entire quantity. So if I go through that subtraction, 2x to the fourth minus 2x to the fourth, of course, gives me 0. Those terms should always go away if we do this correctly. And then I'm going to have x cubed here. And then 4x squared minus 2x squared gives me a positive 2x squared. And then I can bring down these other terms, minus 5x plus 5. And then I go through the process again. This time looking at these two terms. So I'm asking myself, how many times does x cubed go into x cubed? Well, that's an easy answer. That's just 1. Okay, and then once again, now I'm going to take that term I just found, the 1, and multiply it by my expression x cubed minus 2x squared plus x. So, of course, that just gives me x squared minus 2x squared plus x. I'm subtracting that entire quantity, so it looks like I have x cubed minus x cubed, that goes away. Then I have 2x squared minus negative 2x squared, so 4x squared, and then minus 6x plus 5. Okay, now I'm actually done with my long division part because x cubed is not going to go into x squared, right? X cubed has a higher degree than x squared. So this 4x squared minus 6x plus 5 is actually my remainder. So then what we can say is the following, that our original rational expression equals this polynomial we just found, 2x plus 1, and then I need to include my remainder, and the way I'm going to write that is plus 4x squared minus 6x plus 5 over this original denominator, x cubed minus 2x squared plus x. Now notice this expression here, this new rational function with my remainder, is now proper. Right, the degree of the numerator is less than the degree of the denominator, so I can use partial fractions on this rational function. So we're going to leave aside this 2x plus 1 for just a few minutes, and we're just going to focus on doing the partial fraction decomposition of this rational function. Now to do the partial fraction decomposition, the first thing I want to think about is factoring the top, if possible, and the bottom of the fraction. Now, in my case, the top does not factor. You can check that out if you want to, but it's not going to factor in this case. So then, let's just focus on trying to factor this denominator. So the first thing I notice is that every term in the denominator has an x, so I can go ahead and pull out a factor of x, and I'm left with x squared minus 2x plus 1. And then that quadratic there can be factored. That is x minus 1 times x minus 1. So in the bottom then, I end up with x times x minus 1 quantity squared, and then my top is still 4x squared minus 6x plus 5. So now we need to write out the form of the partial fraction decomposition. So notice what my denominator is made up of in this case. I have this x, which is what we call a simple linear factor. And then I have an x minus 1 quantity squared, and we call that a repeated linear factor. So we need to consider the partial fraction decompositions of each of those elements, and then we'll just sum them together. So we know that for simple linear factors, our partial fraction decomposition is just going to look like some constant over that simple linear factor. So then the first term in my decomposition is just going to be a over x, where a is some unknown constant. And now I can think about the partial fraction decomposition of x minus 1 quantity squared. Now for repeated linear factors, what we do is we have that linear factor to each power up to whatever power it's expressed to in the denominator. So in other words, here I'm going to have something over x minus 1 plus something over x minus 1 squared. All right, and then those, once again, are just unknown constants. We'll call them b and c that we'll have to solve for. So now that we have this form, our next step is to go ahead and solve for our coefficients a, b, and c. The way we do that is first by multiplying both sides of this expression by the denominator x times x minus 1 squared, and that's just to eliminate all our denominators. So if we do that, on the left we're just going to be left with 4x squared minus 6x plus 5. On the right, if we distribute this x times x minus 1 squared and simplify, we're going to be left with a times x minus 1 squared plus bx times x minus 1 plus c times x. Now we've learned several ways to solve for coefficients, and once you get into more complicated partial fraction decompositions like this one, where we have repeated linear factors, you sometimes will have to combine different methods or be a little clever in the way you solve for the coefficients. But often a good starting point is to use what we've referred to as the convenient values method. So this relationship here needs to be true for any x value. So then what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick some convenient values of x that are going to allow me to solve for some of my coefficients here. So the first convenient value I'm going to pick is x equals 1. I'm choosing x equals 1 because I notice that's going to make some of these linear factors cancel out. So let's see what happens. So I want to plug in 1 to this whole expression. If I do that, I'm going to get the following. So on the left-hand side, I end up with 4 minus 6 plus 5. And then on the right-hand side, notice that the value attached to the a and to the b, these are both going to give me 0. So all I'm going to be left with is c times 1. So then I end up with 3 equals c. So I found the value of my coefficient c. So let's try another convenient value. It looks like it might also be helpful to let x equal 0. It looks like that might make some things go away. So let's try letting x equal 0. That'll give me the following expression. So then on the left-hand side, I'm just left with 5. On the right-hand side, I'm just left with a times negative 1 squared. The b and the c are going to go away. So I have then 5 equals a. But now I get stuck with this particular method because I haven't solved for b yet, but either one of these convenient values x equals 1 and x equals 0 is going to make b go away. So I need to maybe be a little bit more clever. And there's a few different ways you could go about this. One way is that you could expand this right-hand side, group like powers of x, and then equate like powers of x between the two sides of the expression. That's a good way to do it. A way that might be even a little bit easier is what I'm about to show you. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these two values that I just found, c equals 3 and a equals 5, and I'm just going to go ahead and plug them into this expression. Right? We know c equals 3 and we know a equals 5, so we can plug those in at any point. So I have this expression. There's only one unknown coefficient, b here, and then also my variable x. So now what I can do is I can do sort of a variation on the convenient value method here. This must be true for any value of x, so I can just let x be anything. Of course, I don't want to choose 0 or 1, right, because that would make my b go away. That was the problem above. But I can choose any other value. So let's say let x equal negative 1. And that's going to allow me to come up with an expression in which I can solve for b. So if I let x equal negative 1, I get the following. And then we just need to work on reducing this expression and solving for b. And if you work through all those little steps correctly, you should end up getting b equals negative 1. So now what we've done is we've solved for all three of our coefficients that we are looking for. So then we've pretty much reached our final answer. We just need to write it down. So in this partial fraction decomposition, what we had said is that we knew that 4x squared minus 6x plus 5 over x times x minus 1 squared equaled a over x plus b over x minus 1 plus c over x minus 1 quantity squared. And we now know that that is equal to 5 over x minus 1 over x minus 1 plus, and c was 3, so plus 3 over x minus 1 quantity squared. But remember, this was only part of what we are looking to find, right? We were coming from this this bigger rational function that had this polynomial here. So then what we can say is that this original rational function, this equals this polynomial we got from long division, 2x plus 1, plus the partial fraction decomposition of our remainder.